Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Howling Frequencies, episode 11. I am your host, Sarah. You might have known me previously as the Cinema Cynic. And joining me, as always, is my co-host and boyfriend, Mike.
Shmello.
Today is a great day. We are going to be reviewing a movie that technically is not out yet, but it will be soon, on December 9th, I believe, so this coming Friday, which is Guillermo Del Toro's stop-motion version of Pinocchio, which is a brand new adaptation, and oddly enough, the second Pinocchio adaptation that's come out this year. But I have not seen the other one, which I don't know if, like, it's like the movie we shall not name. Apparently it's very bad, but I'll let Mike fill you in on the details.
Supposedly it's a true story. No doubt the show, rather that true story Pinocchio with Pauly Shore, will be nominated for Oscars. Pauly Shore will probably get an Emmy, something like that. Either way, undoubtedly that one is the undisputed Pinocchio movie.
I was actually referring to the Disney one.
Oh, that one. Okay, never mind.
Okay, so there's been three Pinocchio movies that have come out this year.
I think so, yeah.
That's really crazy. So 2022 was the year of Pinocchio for whatever reason. Oh my goodness. Like, I don't know about you guys. I feel like the movies that have come out this year, the good ones, have been really far and few between. I really needed this. I really needed a movie that I'm like, that I love instantly, like almost from like the first scene, almost all the way till the end. And I can't wait to see it again when it comes out on Netflix.
Same here. Obviously, the first bit is going to be non-spoilers because it's not out yet. Non-spoiler section. Yes, I enjoyed it. Unfortunately, stop motion is one of those, is a dying art. I'm hoping that our boy Guillermo is going to show to all movie studios that it is profitable. You can do it. You just need to be just a little bit patient.
Yes, and can we just acknowledge for a minute just how lucky we are in 2022 to have a stop-motion movie? Because, I mean, I think most people know it's a dying art. People don't want to make stop-motion anymore. It takes too much time. It requires a lot of discipline and patience. But as you said, you know, a lot of people are very hopeful that this will actually start a resurgence of stop-motion. Because, kind of like what we saw in the 90s and early 2000s, because people love it. People will watch it. It's just, it's very difficult compared to other forms of animation.
It is. I think, so we're just going to wait and see. I think the last semi-successful was Isle of Dogs. I enjoyed that one. So, and this one is no exception. And it is fairly ambitious to maybe go toe-to-toe with Disney, but considering how they're doing now, I think, it's an easy win. It is an easy win. I have no idea about Pauly Shore's Pinocchio. I really want to see it. I really wanted to watch it right before we went to the movies for this one. But someone, not going to name any names, didn't want to watch it.
I value my time a lot. Whoops, sorry. I value my time a lot, and I didn't want to spend, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours watching something that I know going into it is going to be really bad.
Yeah, fair enough.
Maybe we'll watch it at some point. I don't know.
Maybe. We'll have to wait and see. Great animation. It was so fluid. I'm just blown away with it. And it's one of those, this stop motion is just keeps getting better and better with the quality, especially now that a lot of people might be demanding more frame rates, and because of that,
yeah, it just keeps getting better and better. Like, I thought, like, once Coraline came out, I'm like, this is peak stop motion. It's never going to get any better than this. Mm-hmm. And this movie proved me wrong, because obviously there's like 10 years of technology advancement between, well, I think a little bit more than that, between Coraline and Pinocchio. So, and you can tell, like, it's wonderful to watch. It's like a true feast for the eyes. One thing that I thought was really interesting is that how we've kind of gotten to a point with animation where we kind of, for artistic reasons, we purposely try to make it look a certain way, even if that's not the most fluid or smooth way for it to look. Like, what I mean by that is, specifically, like, all of the human characters were all very fluid and smooth and exactly what you would expect. But Pinocchio himself was actually very janky. Like, you could see, like, it's almost like they were trying to get him on, like, a... Oh, what is it? Like, less frames per second compared to the human characters, and that makes sense because he's not human, he's made out of wood. So they purposely made the frame rate look worse for him because, you know, he's made out of wood, he's not a real person. And I thought that was a very nice detail.
He wants to be a real boy! Anyways,
what?
I don't know. Anyways. Honestly, I never noticed that. I was just in complete awe when I first saw it, so...
I'm sure I'm gonna notice more details the next time I watch it.
On my big-ass TV here, yeah, we're probably gonna notice more. It's a story that's been told time and time again. No doubt there's been dozens of Pinocchios that have came out.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something that we all know and what to expect. There's a few certain different ideas that Guillermo has woven into this. Obviously, we're not going to spoil anything.
No.
There's just a few things that did catch me off guard, which I was really happy about. The voice acting, everyone did a phenomenal job. The kid who played Pinocchio, fantastic. I had no idea Mike from Stranger Things was in here. It wasn't until I saw the credits, like, oh, holy shit, Mike was here.
Yeah. I think I did see his name in the credits, because I watched when the trailer for this movie came out. I don't really watch trailers anymore.
Yeah, me either.
But I watched this one like 3 or 4 times. Jesus. Because I was so excited for it. And I thought it looked so good. And like, sometimes, very rarely, but sometimes you can watch a trailer and you know just from it that it's going to be good. Yeah. And this movie did not disappoint.
Yeah, Guillermo is one of those directors that they can never do wrong. Like, in my opinion, for my taste, Crimson Peak was probably his worst one yet. Not to say that's a bad movie. Mind you, I only saw it once years and years ago. It wasn't my thing. I didn't feel it, so...
I can't comment. I never saw Crimson Peak, mostly because I heard a lot of mixed reviews about it. But Pan's Labyrinth is one of my favorite movies ever, and I like The Shape of Water as well. So he's... Oh, by the way, I'm not gonna probably have another chance to brag about this. I share a birthday with him. He and I were both born on October 9th.
Jeez.
So that's cool. And I'm very proud of that fact. The boy who did the voice of Pinocchio, I've never heard of him. I'm pretty sure he's new. But do you know who did the voice of Geppetto? And I knew as I was watching the movie, I'm like, this is somebody I know. But I didn't know who it was until I looked into the credits. Do you know who it is?
I do. Like, it's, what's his dick from Game of Thrones?
No, it's, he played, Filch in Harry Potter.
They're the same actor.
Oh, he was in Game of Thrones too. Okay, yeah,
he was also in Hot Fuzz. The
Oh, he was. That's right.
Yeah, yeah, that was like him. So
yeah. Anyway, great. Oh my God, he was like, all the voice acting was great. I'm gonna talk more about Christoph Waltz in a second, but I'm sorry, his name escapes me right now. I think it's Dave Bradley, something Bradley. I could be wrong. He was the best voice actor, I think. Like, you've never seen a version of Geppetto like this before. Like, he was just, I don't think there's ever been a version of him that was just, like, so complex, emotional, and human, for lack of a better word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think that there's more I want to say, but I can't talk about it unless it's in spoilers. So, for me, that kind of wraps up non-spoilers. Do I recommend it? Absolutely. Tune in to Netflix on... Hey, if we're sponsored, then this sounds like a sponsor. But we're not sponsored.
I wish we were sponsored by a streaming giant like Netflix, but sadly, no.
Yeah, so, that being said, yes, tune into it this Friday. Go ahead and watch it. I'm going to edit like a madman to try and get this out before then.
You can do it.
I can do it. Thank you. So, great story, great voice acting.
Great animation.
Great animation.
Great music, too. The score was amazing. The songs were really good, I thought.
Yeah, the music surprised me. Like, it's not as catchy as the original, but I still enjoyed it.
I actually forgot that Pinocchio was a musical, and then they started singing, and I was like, oh, Yeah, that's right. So it was kind of like an unexpected, like a pleasant surprise for me, because I like musicals. They're musicals are kind of a dying art as well, actually, for kind movies. I think that pretty much wraps up the spoiler-free section. So if you don't want to be spoiled, because like we said, even though Pinocchio is a story that's been told many times, it's never been told exactly like this before. So there are some unexpected things that happen. So if you don't want to be spoiled for this version, don't watch any further and just wait until Friday. And please do yourself a favor and watch the movie, because honestly, I think it might be my favorite movie of 2022 so far.
Jesus, that's... Well, the movie. The year's not over. We still have Avatar, The Whale.
That is very true. I've yet to see Avatar 2 and The Whale. So that could change... Those two could change my mind. But for now, as it stands, Pinocchio is my favorite movie of the year.
So, final warning. The next few seconds, we are going to talk about spoilers. One of the new things that they did, or rather, Guillermo's direction here, is Pinocchio being a much more brash child than Disney's version, where we see Pinocchio, like...
Rambunctious.
He's rambunctious. He's an unruly child. And poor Sebastian Cricket, not Jiminy. Sebastian.
No. It's Sebastian J. Cricket. And yeah. I realized halfway through it's because Jiminy Cricket is trademarked by Disney, so they couldn't use that name.
Yeah, so speaking of, Ewan. Okay, wait. Before I move on to that. Squirrel, your thoughts.
Oh, yes. That's actually not what I thought you were going to say, but yeah, maybe not unexpected for people who have read the book or know, how he is in the book, because I was very impressed that this one was a lot closer to the source material than it was, than the Disney version was. And boy, if you thought the Disney one was dark, like the first one, the original Disney one, this makes it look like a joke, this one. And I mean, of course it's Del Toro, of course he's gonna add like his touch of darkness to it, but whew. Anyway, gonna get to that a little bit later, but yeah, no, Pinocchio was a little shit in the book. He killed Jiminy very early on, and he just basically runs amok and causes trouble. So it's very much in line with what Del Toro did here. And it was nice because it made Pinocchio have more of a character arc than in the Disney. And when I refer to the Disney one, whenever I refer to that one, I am referring to the original animated film from 1940, not the remake, because I haven't seen the remake. So I can't compare it to that one. One of my problems with the first, with Disney's Pinocchio, it's fine. It's a fine movie. He doesn't really go through character development. Like, he starts off already pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this Pinocchio is really naughty and a big troublemaker. He's basically acting like a toddler who is, well, he's experiencing the world for the first time. And he wants, as soon as he finds something he likes, he wants it, even if he doesn't know why. And that is, like, so what a toddler going through, like, the terrible twos is like.
Basically. Yeah, and I remember, like, the first introduction of his saying, like, it was so unnatural the way he moved. It looked kind of creepy.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm like, that's Guillermo's twisted humor right there.
And can we please talk about, like, this was one of my favorite scenes, how Pinocchio came into existence in the first place. I really like the direction Del Toro went with this, where it was more like he was creating like a Frankenstein monster almost, yeah, rather than like a doll. In the Disney one, it was like he was already like a puppet maker or whatever, and just he made the puppet and then was like, oh, it'd be cool if this was a real boy, whereas this was made in a during a drunken rage where he's, you know, literally, like, you know, weeping and frustrated consumed by grief, literally, like, drinking until he passes out while he's making Pinocchio.
Yeah, and, like, even the lead up to, like, the birth of Pinocchio is a little tragic. Geppetto, they went through the trouble of maybe 10-20 minutes of the film, like, it showed, they made us care about Geppetto's son.
Carlo,
thank you. And, well, unfortunately, he dies. And
pretty early on.
Pretty early on. So it's so that scene was fairly tragic, where I'm like, wow, they went there. Like they are not pulling their punches on just how dark this movie is. And
nope.
And I'm pretty sure Geppetto probably has a lot of guilt, just because there's a charged object here where there's this pine cone where Geppetto is telling Carlo, yo, pine cone, it has to be perfect. It has to be the one. Carlo finds the one. He forgets the one. And he's blown up trying to get the one.
Yeah, no, it's very tragic. I had no idea that this movie was going to take place during World War II. That was another really big surprise. A very pleasant one, because then, you know, you have all these scenes which incorporate so many interesting elements. You know, Pinocchio has to, he asks questions like, what is war? Why do people go to war? But I don't want to be a soldier, you know, all this. And it brings up all these, like, really interesting philosophical points. Like, you know, just, and,
It is anti-war.
It is anti-war. Well, I mean, Carlo was killed because of the German bombers.
Yeah.
And it just, that, and I can't believe, like, that sentence that I said just now. Like, we're talking about Pinocchio here. Like, it's supposed to be a really light, whimsical fairy tale, and within the first 20 minutes, a child dies from a bombing raid. Like, it's just, it's so tragic. But, I mean, I expect nothing less from Del Toro. He usually adds a lot of tragedy in his movies.
He does, and, now that we're talking about that, I want to go on a little mini side, more like a mini comment about Guillermo's work recently.
Mm-hmm.
There's been a lot of war, a lot of themes about war, because Pan's Labyrinth, war. There's this, war. And
Shape of Water took place during the Cold War, I think.
So, yeah. Like, yeah, so that's where his mind's at right now. Maybe it's quite clear that he does not like war, and war's not good, even though, like, there are some movies like Thin Red Line that try to glorify it with this pretentious dialogue and shit like that. I'm not talking about the Thin Red Line. Anyways. And they went through the trouble of fully flushing out Geppetto as well. You know, like, he's a prominent member of the community.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone knows him. Everyone loves him. Then he suffered through this tragedy, and then he became a drunk. He kind of became kind of like the town joke, or more of a cautionary tale.
I mean, and Disney could have never gotten away with that.
No.
And see, because it's not Disney, Del Toro had so much freedom with this story to make it exactly as dark as he wanted it to be. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's too dark for kids, though. I think kids would still enjoy it. They might not understand, like, the religious references. That was another thing that really surprised me. Like, they do not shy away from, like, the Bible and Jesus and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's like old school Disney type stuff, you know, like stuff we don't see in animated movies anymore. They might not understand, like, the references about the war, like World War II. They might not know who Mussolini is or was, but I think they would still understand, you know, the general gist of the story.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, if kids are watching Squid Game right now, I'm pretty sure they could stomach Pinocchio.
He could probably handle that. I don't know. Was there ever a scene where there was, like, blood or violence in the movie? I don't think so.
Not, like, gruesome violence, but there is violence in here. Like, there's a lot of implied violence.
Yes, there is. I just remember. Okay, so one of my favorite characters in the movie, oh, God, what was his name? He was the carnival guy. He was Count Voldo?
I think so.
I think that's his name. I could be wrong. He is voiced by Christoph Waltz, but I didn't know that during the movie, and the whole time, just like Geppetto, I was thinking, like, I know this voice. I know who this guy is. This isn't a really skilled actor, whoever this is. And then I was like, oh, it's Christoph Waltz, of course, that's why. Wow, what a scumbag. he was such a great villain for this movie. But when he dies, you do hear a crack when he hits the rocks.
Right.
So that was my thinking, like, oh, he either cracked a bone or he cracked his head open. It's kind of implicit, but I mean, that's still pretty dark.
yeah. Christoph Waltz. He's always, I think he's kind of typecasted as, like, this one evil guy. Like, to the point where, like, I do worry that he must be kind of bored with doing that over and over again. He's got a lot of presence. And even in something where we don't actually see his face, you know that he is putting on a performance, and he does move you to the point he's a scary fucking guy. And it's just how charismatic he can be is what makes him terrifying.
Yes. I think he was a big improvement from the Disney version. I think his name was Stromboli, where he was just very loud. That was his only personality trait. And, you know, he did threaten Pinocchio at one point. But no, the count was so much better. Like, he was so much more complex, and he had, like, these little quirks and flares about him. And that was the other thing that I wanted to mention regarding the animation. No two characters move or act exactly the same way. They all have their own different movements. Mm. And, you know, like, little quirks with the anime. You know how hard that would be to do with stop motion to make sure, like, not everybody moves the same? You know, that's quite an accomplishment, I think. It really helps sell their personalities, I think.
I think so, too. And speaking of personalities, I'm surprised the monkey had a lot of personality.
Yeah, he had a, what the hell was his name? It was like a long Italian name. Spazzatura? Spazzatura?
We'll call him Sparsky for now.
Anyway, he had a bit of a redemption arc, too.
He did, actually. Yeah. Like, at first he's just like this for the count. Mm-hmm. Where, like, he's talent scouting, he saw this golden egg, which Pinocchio has signed something, which is, has bound him to the count.
Mm-hmm.
But anyways, that being said, yeah, at first, like, he went through that, and then eventually, like, the count's being very deceitful. Mm-hmm. He's being a dick.
Yeah.
He's using the boy wood to his advantage, and Sparsky ends up saving Boy Wood.
Yeah, no, it was actually quite dark, you know, because, like, it's weird. You Pinocchio is so full of life, you very often forget, at least I did, I very often forgot that he was made of wood, until the Count strapped him to a fucking pyre and, like, was gonna set him on fire. And I'm like, oh shit, that's really dark, Del Toro. Like, even for you, he's technically a child, and you're gonna burn him alive. But thankfully, the monkey saves him. Because he was repaying Pinocchio for when he stood up for him earlier on in the movie.
Before we do continue to gush about this movie, I think which we usually start with this, cons, really quick.
Mm.
There's very few of them. I think in middle of the second act, leading toward the third act, there was this, while I see the importance of the scene, while I see that it weaves into the anti-war, is Pinocchio going to boot camp, training camp, something like that.
Oh, yeah, that scene.
Like,
yeah.
That was kind of a harsh transition where there was little to no lead up. Pinocchio just goes to it right away. But mind you, there's a few other story elements that have been woven in there. Pinocchio is kind of immortal. There's a few rules to him being immortal, though.
Yeah.
And so, of course, like, we don't know what his physical body is going through during this process of resurrection. So, because of that, he wakes up and he's going to training camp. And while it's been hinted at that Ron Perlman's character, I forget his fucking name.
I forget his name, too.
Okay, we'll just call him Ron for now. So, Ron knows the value of Pinocchio as a soldier, even though it's kind of like the flaw of, like, dinosaurs would be the best soldiers. Pinocchio's made of wood, all right? One grenade's going to blow him to bits anyway.
But that's the whole thing, right? He's immortal. He actually can't die. There are rules that are explained through the very uniquely designed version of the Blue Angel in this version. Actually, there's two of them.
Two of them.
There's like one that represents life, and there's the other that represents death, I think. Yeah. I think that's what Del Toro was going for.
Yes.
Anyway, the ultimate soldier is a soldier who can't die. And I would actually disagree that there was no lead up to it. I mean, yes, it was kind of sudden from what he was just doing.
Yeah.
But there was a little bit of lead up because that Ron Perlman's character was there. Okay, Ron Perlman's character was there from almost the beginning, like from some of the earlier scenes. So, and you know, he kept going on about, you know, the Italian fascist propaganda. So they were sprinkling little foreshadowing hints.
Yeah, that's a really quick. I do want to interrupt you. There's one gesture in there that actually surprised me that Guillermo actually put in there was the Nazi salute.
Yes.
Like, that surprised me. Like, I'm like,
Disney could not do that either.
No, definitely not. And then Ron did that. Well, not actually Ron Perlman's character, he actually did that. Like, whoa, okay, I was not expecting that.
Okay, so this movie is going there. Okay, cool. Honestly, I haven't been this... The last time there was an animated movie that went there, that went so dark, was probably Hunchback of Notre Dame, the Disney one. That was probably the only other movie I can think to compare this to in terms of, like, oh, wow, they're actually going there. Like, they're not holding back at all.
Yeah.
You know, and even that was tame by comparison, I guess. Mm-hmm. But, it's all relative. Yeah, Nazi salutes. Was not expecting to see that.
Yeah, like, I generally was not expecting that.
You notice how they never actually showed the swastika, but
they implied it.
They did imply it a couple of times, yeah. Because the band around the arm was red, but it didn't have the swastika on it.
Yeah, I do want to take us a couple chapters back. The angels. One look at them, you can immediately tell that is Guillermo's design.
Mm-hmm.
It's very distinct. You can really tell what creation he made. And it's very stylized, and there's a lot of grace with them, the way they move. Like, they move like cats.
Mm-hmm.
So, and there's a lot of mystique with them. We obviously get to know more about the angel of death as opposed to life. There's a huge dynamic with them as well, so they were great additions to Pinocchio, and yeah, I enjoyed every minute with them.
Weren't we talking about cons, though? I mean, I agree with you, but...
God damn it, okay.
I thought you were going to say, like, something bad about them for
No, okay, no. Literally, the only con that I had was the harsh transition to Pinocchio going into the training camp.
Yeah, my cons are very few as well, which is so refreshing compared to, like, freaking the last movie we saw, Halloween Ends, which was just fucking full of cons. Okay, so, like, the boot camp scene, I understand its purpose. It, for me, it was kind of jarring, but in a different way. It was kind of in the opposite direction. So you have this really dark film, and then there's a scene where Pinocchio decides he's gonna take revenge on the Count. And while Mussolini is in attendance, he's gonna sing this really childish song about him. And I understand the anti-war message. I understand why it needed to be there. But for me, it actually almost took me out of the movie a little bit.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, yeah, I get that Pinocchio is childish, but this is almost a little too childish for me. Right. But other than that, literally every other scene was perfect.
I don't know much about, like, Guillermo's personal life. Either that or he's just this talented of a creator. But me thinks he might have daddy issues because... Mike's dad.
Oh, Candlewick, that was his name.
Yeah, him, thank you. Candlewick.
Yeah.
Candlewick's dad was kind of a dick.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, through and through, like, right down to the end, where, like, he is, like, with an iron fist, like, everything about the fascist regime. Everything about the fascist regime, so...
Yeah, he keeps pushing that message, like, you gotta be a true Italian, you gotta fight for Mussolini, you know, and all this stuff, and it's like... And his son finally stands up to him at the end, and he's like, okay, fine, if that's how you want to be, shoot the puppet. And first of all, it's like, well, we know at this point Pinocchio can't die.
Yeah.
But that's not the point. The point is, he doesn't know that. So he wanted his son to kill Pinocchio for fascism reasons. And I was actually, you know, normally in an animated movie, I do feel a little bit sorry for the villains when they die. I felt no sympathy for him when he died. And the only reason I felt sympathy for the Count when he died is because I was sad that he was gone. Oh. And he would have no more scenes. I think, you know, it's ironic. I think Ron's character got blown up by his own grenade, if I recall correctly. I could be wrong.
The irony, so.
Yeah, very ironic.
Yeah, like, in comparison to Disney's remake, which I had the misfortune in watching. this one, it's literally night and day. Leaps and bounds in quality. This is a true remake through and through. And now that we're here, I do want to talk about one of my favorite actors, Ewan McGregor.
Yes, I was waiting for you, Sebastian. I was waiting for you to bring him up.
He's fucking hilarious. Like, there's a lot of funny scenes. Like, some scenes you actually do kind of call. Like, when he started singing, in the back of my mind, I was like, something's going to interrupt him. And something does interrupt him. But even that, the execution of it and the timing of it. It's priceless.
Even though it was expected, it was still funny. Yes. And just, oh my goodness. Poor Sebastian. He just goes through so much shit in this movie. He gets squashed on, stepped on. He gets a door slammed into him. Just, oh, the poor little cricket. I felt so sorry for him. And Ewan did a really good job.
He did. Like, even even Sebastian here. He had quite the arc. Like, at first...
He did.
Like, when we're talking about, like, the original 1940, Jiminy was gung-ho about the whole thing of being the guardian, or the moral compass for Pinocchio. Sebastian here, like, he did not care. Like, he just wanted to write his book. He wanted to write his memoirs and share his tale. And he did not care about Pinocchio at all. All he originally saw is Pinocchio... It was just a mobile home.
Yeah, exactly. You know, what did he say when Pinocchio accidentally set his legs on fire? Oh my god, my home is on fire. Not, oh my god, Pinocchio's on fire. You know, he started off really selfish, actually.
Yeah.
You know, and you know what I just realized just now is that a lot of the characters go through an arc. At least the three main characters. Pinocchio, Geppetto, and Sebastian. I keep wanting to say Jiminy, but that's not his name. don't come after us, Disney. Yeah, he was great, and just I feel like Del Toro, just, like, not as, like, a fuck you or a middle finger to Disney, but I feel like he really tried to go against the grain as much as possible with this story, because a lot of it has been Disney-fied over the years, and a lot of it has kind of moved, like, shifted away from the original source material. This is him being like, no, we gotta go back to the roots. What is this story actually about? You know, and what I kind of took from it... Oh, actually, sorry, before I go, you can say something.
It's a story, it's a theme that's been told time and time again, where what does it mean to be human?
Yes.
And Pinocchio, for the most part, he actually does figure it out. He does figure it out on his own, Waltz. And they went through the trouble of not having Sebastian being present with him all the time, as opposed to the 1940, where Jiminy was with Pinocchio through thick and thin. Here, Pinocchio was mostly on his own.
Yeah, that is maybe... See, I'm getting into nitpick territory at this point. Like, that was maybe the only other con, if I really had to dig deep for one, is maybe that Sebastian wasn't with Pinocchio enough. But then again, that is more accurate to the book. He wasn't with him 24/7. And just because, like, you know how he gets that wish at the end?
Yeah.
And I felt like he didn't really earn it because he wasn't really with Pinocchio for the most part. But to be fair, he did say, like, oh, well, I tried my best, you know, kind of thing. But things didn't really work out, you know. And it's like, I mean, yeah, it's a great lesson to teach kids. Like, even if you try your best, things still might not work out in your favor.
Speaking of not working on people's favor, I'm pretty sure this was taken right out of the 70s, where the whale blowing up to bits and pieces. And
Oh my god, do you remember what I said to you in the theater when that happened? I, like, shook Mike's arm and I was like, oh, it's just like what happened in the 70s. And I don't know, maybe you want to fill people in on what happened.
Okay, so, unlike the 1940s, where... Fuck, what's the whale's name again?
Monstro.
Thank you. Monstro. So, where they just smoke it out and Monstro has this little action scene, but eventually it fucks off and it continues to terrorize the ocean. Here, no. Gilman, I was like, nah, fam. I've seen that shit in the 70s. It traumatized me, but it made me laugh. So I gotta put this in.
Yeah, the whale fucking blows up. Like, Del Toro, it just dialed this story to all the way to 100, like, in every sense, including with the battle with Monstro.
It was both glorious to see. It was both funny, even though, like, I do not condone animal violence. But at the end of the day, like, this is just a physical puppet.
It's just a puppet, yeah. No, but the reason why Mike and I thought it was so funny is because, for those of you who don't know, there was an incident in the 1970s, I believe this was Oregon, where this happened, where a whale washed up on the beach. They tried to remove it, and they couldn't for some reason. So they had the brilliant idea, sarcasm, of sticking dynamite into the whale and just blowing it up.
I think it was like 20 pounds of dynamite or some shit like that.
And this backfired on them horribly, because literally chunks of whale went everywhere, like landing on people's cars, on people's homes. You know, just imagine calling your boss that morning. Like, I'm sorry I can't come into work today, but a piece of a fucking whale landed on my car.
No, like, it did some serious damage, like, to the point where, like, people were running. And because, unfortunately, speed and velocity is a thing. And there's actual footage where cars are actually caved in. Like, that's just how dangerous that shit was. So
yeah, and so as soon as that happened in the movie, Mike and I were just giggling away, because that's all we could think of. But you know where I wasn't giggling? Was the ending. And god damn it, Del Toro's movies always make me cry. I should have known going into it, but it was just, I think it was one of Geppetto's lines. Like, I was already starting to tear up when, you know, they do the fake out where you think Pinocchio's dead. I'm thinking, this isn't Disney. This is Del Toro. Yeah. Pinocchio might actually be dead.
Yeah.
So I was worried about that. But then when Pinocchio is brought back to life through Sebastian's wish that he uses, the fairy or the angel, whatever you want to call her, she promised him a wish if he agreed to look after Pinocchio and keep him out of trouble. So at the end, he uses his wish to bring him back, because Geppetto is just, like, he's finally at a point where Pinocchio, he doesn't see Pinocchio as a burden anymore. Like, he actually loves him and accepts him for mm-hmm. who he is. And he says that to Pinocchio, I love you and I accept you just as you are. You know, I don't want you to be like Carlo. I don't want you to be like anyone else. I want you to be you. And I don't know, that broke me. Because I think, like, that's something that I've struggled a lot with my parents personally. Just having expectations of trying to be someone I'm not, I guess. Or, like, you know, you want to make them proud, but you keep messing up. And just, like, yeah, that really hit me hard. And I was, like, bawling.
Yeah.
And then you just very casually, you know, without missing a beat, you just, like, handed me some, like, napkins to wipe my eyes.
And you're like, you fucking psycho, you knew this is gonna happen? yeah, like, that scene was very sad, and even, like, the ending itself, where this was implied, that it was hinted that Pinocchio's long life, he will see people go. Mm-hmm. And right here, like, you always hear that cliche, immortality is a curse.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, we actually do see it. Pinocchio is the last one standing. He had to say goodbye to all of his friends. He had to lay them all to rest. But then Pinocchio, being the sentimental wooden bastard that he is, he's put each of their graves on the same spot where Carlo was, where his technical birthplace was, because I think he is...
Mm-hmm.
Because technically he's a tree, so.
He was carved from the tree that was next to Carlo's grave. Yes. Actually, and this kind of brings me to, yes, I'll touch up on that point first that you made. So I think one of the main moral messages that Del Toro was putting in this movie, and there's always a message with his movies,
yeah,
is that you don't know how much time you have, mm-hmm, so savor it, because, you know, one day we'll all be gone. And that is true. And I think he taught that to kids in a way that's not going to make them have an existential crisis, which is good. Because I've definitely had my fair share of those, like, whenever I think about, like, oh my god, I'm gonna die one day, you know? Yeah. But this movie almost, like, softens the blow of that realization, yeah, a little bit. In a way that's honest, but also beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I wanted to ask, and this is my own theory that I was developing while I was watching it, but they did imply this at some points. So, do you remember the first time that Pinocchio encountered the Angel of Death? And you remember what she said? She said, "I feel like you've been here before."
Mm.
The wooden boy with the borrowed soul. And I'm thinking, like, is Carlos's soul in Pinocchio? But it's like he lost all of his memories. And he doesn't know how to be a good boy. And he has to relearn that.
When she first said that, I didn't think too deeply into it. I thought she was just saying that, oh, it's the same story, Pinocchio. So,
oh, interesting.
That's what I was thinking, like, because in this case, it's the third Pinocchio title that's been out this year.
And is the most superior, by far. Is
the most superior, close to as Polly Shore's.
I'm just going to say it. I think this one's better than the Disney version. Like, the original, I mean.
No, I agree. Like, yeah. This one definitely, like, 2 billion, fifillion, trillion, quadrillion percent.
anyway, sorry. Blue Fairy, or Blue Angel. I don't actually know what she's called in this one.
We'll just call one Life and Death.
Sure, whatever. Anyway, that was just something that I was thinking about during the movie. Like, I know there is a message, or not a message, but something that the Life Fairy says at the end, where she says, "I'm sorry, but real boys don't come back." Which kind of makes me think, okay, maybe Carlo, like, was actually dead for good. Which is pretty brutal, but also, like, yeah, it's important to teach kids, like, what death is.
Yeah.
No. You know, so they can learn to cope with it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, just the wooden boy with the borrowed soul. Like, I feel like that line isn't arbitrary. Like, they wouldn't have put that in for no reason. Oh, and he also knew the song that Geppetto sang for Carlo at the beginning of the movie. And Geppetto was like, how do you know that song? How do you even know that? So that makes me think, oh, maybe. Like, they didn't outright say it.
So it's just Carlo reincarnate.
That's what I think.
Just slightly more bratty.
But again, he forgot how to be good when he was reborn. So he has to relearn that. So in a way, Geppetto does get Carlo back. In a spiritual way, I guess.
In a spiritual way. And who is Carlo's mother? We don't know.
Yeah, this is a trope that's in a lot of movies.
They pulled the Christopher Nolan for Batman Begins. Your father would be ashamed of you. You know, there's a mother too, you know. Anyways, we're not talking about Batman.
but see, this is such a common trope in movies where it's usually a single parent and it's always the dad for whatever reason. I don't know if it's because the birth mortality rate was still high back then, where, like, you know, moms dying while giving birth or whatever. Like, I mean, that would be fair, I guess. But yeah, you do see that a lot in movies, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Where it's a single dad, usually. Single parent, either way.
Single parents, yeah.
But usually the dad.
Usually the daddy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we're approaching an hour, so we probably should wrap this up.
Mm-hmm.
So, final thoughts. I enjoyed the hell out of this movie. I'm absolutely going to watch it again.
Me too.
I really hope that this is going to get nominated for an Oscar, but considering the very slim pickings of 2022, this one stands out over Lightyear, Strange World, yeah. So, apparently that's not doing too well. I'm not sure if it's just because poor marketing or people are just done with Disney. I have no idea.
Hmm.
But either way, this one is definitely my top animated movie of this year.
Oh, definitely. I think it has a really good chance of winning Best Animated Movie. Normally, Disney and Pixar have a monopoly over this kind of thing, and if they come out with a movie, they will almost always win. But like you said, it was very slim pickings this year. The only other movie I can think of that might stand a chance is maybe Turning Red, which I heard was quite good. That was very early this year. That feels like a million years ago now. I think it was February when it came out.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, but no, I think this has a really good chance of winning, and it really deserves it. I mean, again, we are so lucky to have a stop-motion movie this year. And it was so nice. This was the first stop-motion movie I had seen in the theaters since Coraline. That was over 10 bloody years ago. It was so nice to see one on the big screen again. And I'm definitely going to rewatch this. As it stands right now, as I said before, this is my favorite movie of 2022. But let's see if I get proven wrong.
Agreed. So, can't wait to watch it again this weekend. I might wait for you. So that being said, yeah, go watch it. Tune in on Friday to show everyone that stop motion is fucking awesome.
Yes. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to have seen it before the official release date. That doesn't happen very often. So thank you again, Mike, for securing our seats and booking those tickets for us.
But of course.
And I really hope you guys enjoy it as much as we did when it comes out. And you only have to wait a little less than a week now for it.
Yeah.
So go support it. Support stop motion. Support Del Toro. He's a great guy. He's a great director.
Yeah, it's basically the year of Guillermo between the Cabinet of Curiosities and this.
It's Guillermo, by the way. Not I don't know how you were saying it, though.
Guillermo?
Yeah, that's not how you say his name. Guillermo.
Guillermo.
Yes, there you go.
Okay.
Thank you so much for watching, guys. Please give us a like, a comment, or subscribe if you haven't already. Stay safe out there, and we'll see you in the next one.
Don't forget to spay and neuter your pets.
And don't forget to spay and neuter your pets. Wise words.